Welcome. In this video, we'll see some of the basic architectures of CPU and we'll see the detailed architecture of PIC16F877 microcontroller. So the two CPU architectures are von Neumann architecture and Harvard architecture. So in case of von Neumann architecture, there is only one bus between CPU and memory. So there is no distinguish between data and instructions for the CPU, because the same bus is used to transfer the instructions to the CPU from memory, as well as the same bus is used to transfer the data from memory to CPU and from CPU to memory. So there is no any distinguish between data and instructions. And other thing is that the RAM and program memory must have same bit width, because the same bus is used for connecting the program memory and data memory to CPU. The bit width of both these memories should be same. In case of Harvard architecture, program memory and data memory are separate. It means that the separate buses are used for accessing the program memory and data memory. So there is clear distinguish between data and the instructions. So using one bus, the instructions are fetched, and using another bus, the data is fetched by the CPU. So data and program memory can have different bit widths. So in case of Harvard architecture, since the buses are separate, the bit widths of both program memory as well as data memory can be different. So this different bit width helps for instruction pipelining. Since the buses are separate, in a single clock cycle, instruction can also be fetched as well as data can also be fetched. So this helps for implementing a structure called as pipelining. So using this pipelining, the instructions can be executed in a staggered manner, and this improves the throughput of the entire system. So this is just the representation of the architectures. So first we have the von Neumann architecture, in which a same common data bus is used for accessing the instructions as well as for accessing the data from the memory. Whereas in case of Harvard architecture, we have separate bus for accessing the data memory and separate bus for accessing the program memory. It means that there is clear distinguish between instructions and data, and both these buses are separate. So the advantage is that we can have a data memory of different bit width and we can have a program memory of different bit width. So again, some differences are that a single bus is used for both data and instructions. So instruction fetch and data transfer must be scheduled. So first of all, generally instruction is fetched and then the data is fetched in case of von Neumann architecture. Whereas for Harvard architecture, since there are separate data and instruction buses, it allows simultaneous transfers or access to the program memory as well as data memory. So in a single clock cycle, the instruction can also be fetched and data can also be fetched. Whereas in case of von Neumann, it is sequential. Either first instruction will be fetched and then the data will be fetched. So it requires at least two clock cycles. So this von Neumann architecture is relatively older architecture and it is having a lower performance as compared to the Harvard architecture. So this Harvard architecture is a newer version and a high performance architecture. And another thing about this Harvard architecture is that most of the instructions can be executed in a single clock cycle. So now we'll see the detailed internal architecture of a PIC16F877 microcontroller. So this is the internal architecture of a PIC microcontroller. We have different blocks like flash program memory. Then we have a program counter, which is used to keep the track of which instruction is being executed. Then we have a stack, which is used for storing the address of program counter. Then we have RAM, that is file registers. This is a general purpose RAM, which can be used for storing temporary data. This flash memory or program memory is used to store the program or the code. Then we have different peripherals here. So starting with all ports, so there are five ports: port A, port B, port C, port D, and port E. So all the ports are having different pins, and all these pins are again multiplexed with some other functions. Next we have here the ALU. So ALU is the arithmetic and logic unit. So it is connected with different multiplexers and different resistors where from where the data will be accessed, and it will be given as input to the ALU for arithmetic and logical operations. Then we have FSR, that is called as file selection register, which is used for indirect addressing mode. Then we have a status register, which has the different flags related to different operations. Then we have different features in PIC available over here, that is power up timer, oscillator startup timer, power on reset, watchdog timer, brownout reset, and in circuit debugger and low voltage programming. So all these features are available in PIC16F877. Then we have different blocks like instruction register, instruction decode and control, timing generation, which is used by the CPU for internal operations. Then we have a parallel slave port, which can be used for interfacing a parallel device to PIC16F877 controller. Then we have some more peripherals like timer 0, timer 1, timer 2. So these timers can be used for generating a delay. This is the basic use of a timer. Then we have a 10-bit A to D converter inbuilt inside PIC controller, which can be used to convert analog signal into a digital signal. Then we have a USART, that is universal synchronous asynchronous receiver transmitter. Again, this is used for serial transmission and reception of the data. Then we have synchronous serial port. So using this synchronous serial port, we can implement two protocols, SPI or I2C. So again, it is used for sending or receiving data serially. Then we have CCP1 and 2. This CCP stands for capture compare PWM module. So two modules are there, which have that function of capture, compare, and PWM. And finally, we have data square prom. Again, this data square prom is used for storing a user data, which is not going to change frequently. So this is the internal architecture of a PIC16F877 controller. And finally, this is the pinout of PIC16F877, and this pinout is compatible with some other ICs in that family, like PIC16F874 as well. So this IC is of 40 pin, and this is a PDIP package, that is plastic dual inline package. And different pins are there, which and all these pins are having multiple functions. So we can use only one function at a time for a particular pin. So all these pins are having multiplexed functions. So that is about the internal architecture of PIC controller. In the next video, we'll see the memory organization present in PIC16F877 controller. Thank you.